The organic chemistry that you've learned over the last year gives you the foundation to understand molecular level detail of virtually any biological process that we know about today. I want to illustrate this to you in the next 5 webcasts by looking in great detail at one particular biosynthetic pathway. It's called the Shikimate or the Shikimate Pathway. It's the pathway by which plants make the aromatic amino acids from simple building block precursors. This is a pathway that's going to tie together a number of different points. We're going to look at enzyme catalysis. We'll look at carbon-carbon bond forming steps. We'll look at stereochemistry. We'll look at elimination, phosphorylation. Many of the things that we've been discussing up till now, we're going to tie together with this particular pathway. And we'll also look at one new concept, the concept of isomerization reactions. The main reason, though, that you're going to look at this isn't so much to gain understanding of all of the details of this pathway. You will be able to do that. But the most important thing isn't so much the details of this one synthetic pathway, but it is a recognition that with the knowledge you now possess, you have the ability to understand the details at a molecular level of what goes on in this complex biological process. Knowing that you can do that for this one pathway should give you confidence to know that you can apply these ideas to virtually any biology that you see and try to understand what's going on at the molecular level. We want to look at this from the way that an organic chemist would look at it, and in doing so, we're going to tie together a number of points, and we'll see that you have the ability to apply this to many other biological processes. That's the main point of what we want to do. In this webcast, what remains is just for me to introduce you to the Shikimate pathway and why it's important to study, why it is actually an important biosynthetic process to study. So basically, the aromatic amino acids contain, like phenylalanine or tyrosine, contain 9 carbon atoms. And those 9 carbon atoms come together from the 3 building blocks that you see here. 4 of the carbon atoms, come from erythrose 4-phosphate. And then 3 atoms come from 2 molecules each of phosphoenolpyruvate. And so altogether, that's 10 carbon atoms. And I told you there were 9 carbon atoms in phenylalanine or tyrosine. So there's going to be a decarboxylation along the way. But those are as we go through the details of how these amino acids are put together, it's those 10 carbon atoms that you see highlighted there that we're going to want to follow and track throughout the entire process. These 3 building blocks come together. They make a key intermediate at first. That key intermediate is known as prephenate. That's the precursor to both tyrosine and then phenylalanine, in which this hydroxyl group is lost. Obviously, this is the point of decarboxylation, and this is going to be this position here, as you can see, is going to become the is going to become the position where the alpha amino position is. The amino group is going to be attached to that carbon atom there. So overall, this process that plants use is known as a biosynthetic pathway. Biosynthesis is the synthesis that takes place in natural systems, building up larger, more complex molecules from simple precursors. And the reason that this particular pathway is important to study is because it is a pathway common only to plants. We as humans don't possess this particular pathway. We need to, in fact, ingest all of the aromatic amino acids that our bodies need. We don't have the ability to produce them for ourselves. And this gets back to the ideas that we mentioned a while back of selective toxicity. If we want to kill off a plant and not harm humans, this is a great pathway by which we could target. So any of the enzymes that are involved in this particular pathway would be a suitable enzyme to target for selectively inducing toxicity into a plant. And for example, it's used all the time in killing weeds for Roundup is the inhibitor of one of the key intermediates or the key enzymes that lead to the prephenate, and we'll look at that in great detail and understand what's the molecular basis of Roundup, how it works, and And then something more spectacular and something more meaningful yet is the marriage of organic chemistry, which produced Roundup, and molecular biology and genetics, which produces a genetic line of engineered crops that are tolerant to the inhibitor that's in Roundup, that allow this pathway to continue because of a mutation, while naturally occurring weeds are eliminated by the inhibitor in Roundup, the genetic modification is not. So the marriage of organic chemistry and molecular biology and genetics has really delivered something of great value to humankind, that is the ability to grow crops that are essentially weed-free.